Okay, welcome everyone. I will, although you can't see me on screen, I'll briefly introduce myself. My name's Phil Booth. I'm the director of the Oxford Centre for Late Antiquity. I'm here as a stand-in for Peter Frankopan, the director of the Oxford Centre for Byzantine Research, who unfortunately is self-isolating, having developed some symptoms of the virus. So I'm sure we all wish Peter well. It's my great pleasure to welcome Professor Monica Green. Professor Green gained her PhD from Princeton, and then since held jobs at Princeton itself, at the University of North Carolina, at Duke, at Arizona State, and she's held numerous very prestigious fellowships, both in the United States and in Europe. And we're delighted that she's now here as a visiting fellow of the Oxford Centre for Byzantine Research. Professor Green is an expert in women's healthcare in medieval Europe and in the global history of disease, on which she has written several prize-winning books and edited several volumes. She's currently writing The Black Death, A Global History. And today she'll speak to us on that same theme. Her paper is entitled, What Happens When We Expand the Chronology and Geography of Plague's History.
Thank you very much, and thank you to all at the Byzantine Studies Center for the invitation and for the very warm welcome today.
With hand sanitizer at the ready.
I have added the subtitle to the talk today, What Happens When We Expand the Chronology and Geography of Plague's History, or Why Yersinia pestis is a Good Model Organism in These Pandemic Times. So this talk was organized several months ago before any of us had any idea of the situation we would find ourselves in right now. But part of what I want to do today is talk about the ways in which what the situation we're in right now was predicted, what ways it is telling us a story we already knew was going to happen in some kind of ways. The cast of players is different than any of us had expected, but the general unfolding of this process is pretty much something that we already knew. So I'm a medievalist. I trained as a historian of medieval Europe. For medieval Europe, the two big diseases are plague and leprosy. And plague and leprosy are the also the diseases that just fortuitously have been leading the way in new transitions in the scientific approach to the history of disease. And that's essentially what I'll be talking about today. So there will be a lot of science in this presentation. So where we are today right now, and I hope this map and the diagrams are familiar to you already, is what we're dealing with a global disease. This is a global disease that was facilitated, as you already know, by air travel. But it is not the first global disease. AIDS is not the first global disease. We have actually had global diseases for hundreds of years. And that's essentially the phenomenon that I'm talking about, is where do infectious diseases come from? How do they spread? How are they maintained in human societies? This is a very new disease. We also have very old diseases, but they are comparable in a variety of ways. This is the headline of the BBC News on the day I arrived in the UK at the beginning of the month. World in uncharted territory on coronavirus. That's true and it's not true. It's uncharted territory in the sense that this really is a new disease. It's a new organism that has gone through, we don't know yet, what processes through other animals and come into human populations. It's not uncharted territory in the sense that we've seen similar things before. Not simply with SARS as another coronavirus, but with various other bacterial, viral, and other kinds of microorganisms that have caused disease. What does it mean that we're calling this a pandemic? Pandemic means simply it's affecting populations. This is a definition that was published in 2009 after the SARS pandemic. Tony Fauci is probably the name that will be most familiar to you right now. So pandemic of this definition that was proposed is wide geographic extension. Disease movement, that the disease is actually moving quickly across a geographic range. High attack rates and explosiveness, that it's actually affecting a lot of people very quickly. Minimal population immunity, that the population has not seen this before and therefore has nothing other than an innate immune response to the infection. Novelty, again, it's a new disease. Infectiousness, meaning it can infect, it can come into human bodies. And contagiousness, meaning we can transmit it to each other. And severity. So there's actually a variety of diseases that fit this definition. What I've been trying to do the past decade is suggest that my discipline, which is normally called the history of medicine, can be expanded to take advantage of new work that's been happening in the sciences, particularly genetics, which is mostly what I'll be talking about today, but other fields of science. And essentially what we have done as historians of medicine for decades, in fact centuries, is we look at what doctors do, we look at what other health practitioners do, we look at the institutions, either educational institutions or hospitals that deliver health care in various ways. We look at the history of public health, and only belatedly in the last several decades have we looked systematically at the experiences of patients. What I'm suggesting is that's the medical structure. What I'm suggesting is we also ask, why are people sick in the first place? Why are these diseases present in human populations? Why do we have to seek out doctors and institutions? So what I want to do today, and I'll be going much more quickly than I normally would in this kind of presentation, because we will also be opening up the floor, not simply to questions of the people who are in the room with us today, but also to questions via Twitter. And I also want to say that if I don't get the questions all answered during the time that we have, I'll follow up on Twitter in the next 24 hours. So plague, I'm assuming everybody has heard of plague, have some idea what plague is. It is the cause of three pandemics, one of them still usually called the largest pandemic in human history, the Black Death. There are various ways that we need to analyze that, talking about, and in fact, many new ways in which we are starting to rethink the history of these plague pandemics, of looking at climate factors, looking at population density, looking at trade networks, reservoirs, where the disease lies. I'm not going to be talking about those today just because we don't have time to do everything. I want to talk about the ways in which there's a new way of analyzing, a new way of constructing a history of a disease, which is instead of looking at humans and the ways in which humans suffer, die, spread the disease around or respond to it, we can actually look at the pathogen itself. And then I also want to say, in what ways is plague, which is very different from the coronavirus, plague is a bacterial disease. Plague is a disease that's primarily passed through rodent populations. Why is this very different disease perhaps a model organism for our present times? What can we learn from this very different disease experience that will tell us something helpful for us today? Okay, so very quickly, this is a map published by Benedicto in 2004 about where the Black Death happened. And as you'll notice, it's only showing Europe and the very northern part of Africa around the Mediterranean. That is the traditional story that we tell about plague. We're using European sources, we're using Arabic sources, and a certain amount of Greek sources as well, to tell the Byzantine part of this story. But that is the normal story that we tell. I've always had a problem with this map, and I've always had the problem with the narrative that goes with this map, which is, where's the rest of Eurasia? Where's the rest of Africa? Why would a disease that lives in rodents have been limited in such a way? So this is a problem, a long-standing problem. And this is now what I'm calling the new paradigm in plague studies, is thinking not just looking at human-produced sources, so things that are written by humans. I'm assuming most people are familiar with Boccaccio's description of the plague in Florence. There are many other sources that we commonly use to tell the story of plague. But there are a lot of other stories because, again, plague is not a human disease. So what we historians have traditionally done is we've looked at the human part of the story. But if you add other disciplines as well, you see that archaeologists actually are also very interested in the human story. To some extent, and this is a much smaller group, but there are archaeological ways of documenting the history of rodents, too. It's a much harder work for a variety of reasons, but it can and is being done. The geneticists, who I'll be talking about, thus far have been focusing on the bacterium. But you can see, just from this diagram, that's a long way away from getting the human story of this. So in what ways do we need to think across these different species? The flea, unfortunately, can hardly be documented at all historically. Population biologists or the scientists who use mathematics to do modeling are coming up with some ideas about how to reconstruct possible history. And entomologists working with modern samples have given us a lot of information. But you can see how many different kinds of investigators have to be involved in this work. Well, this book that I edited in 2014, which was republished in 2015, Pandemic Disease in the Medieval World, was a first attempt to say, how can we talk across all of these disciplines? How can we create a new synthesis? So what I want to do first is talk about the science, and then I want to talk about the mostly the humanistic and primarily the contributions that historians can bring to this. So the science is simply this. This is one of the most lethal diseases on the planet. This is just the most succinct summary of what plague actually does in its mammalian host after after the flea bite transmits it. So this is a strain of plague that's been altered with a bioluminescent tracing element. And so this is showing the initial part of that is the mouse on the left has been infected, and that's one day after the initial inoculation, which is more or less equivalent to what might be transmitted by one flea bite. Second day, it is now spreading into the lymph nodes. The third day, it is spreading from, you'll notice the lymph node in the groin, up to the lymph node under the arm. So it's actually using the lymph system, which is part of the body's own immune system, to spread throughout the body. And that's essentially what it does. It essentially takes command of the immune system. Fourth day, it is spreading throughout the mesenteric, the region around the gut, where there are also lymph nodes. And then the final day is the point just before death, where it is now spread into the bloodstream is spreading throughout the body. This would basically look the same for a human. It will kill a human, bubonic transmission, in about 6 to 10 days. You can also inhale it. If somebody has it in their lungs and they cough, spit, you can inhale it directly in your lungs and you'll probably be dead in 2 to 3 days once you become symptomatic. Okay, so one of the ironies about plague is it kills you so quickly it doesn't leave any trace in your bones. And that's been one of the reasons why there was for many decades a debate about whether plague, as caused by Yersinia pestis, was actually the cause of the Black Death. The new genetics work, and this is by no means the only study. There was 20 years of work prior to this that was leading up to this breakthrough study in 2011. But it is it was transformational for a variety of reasons. This was a study based on a Black Death cemetery here in the UK in London. We know when the cemetery was created because we have the sale documents. We know when it was consecrated. We also know when the cemetery was closed, again, because we have the land was sold and used by another group. So this is a breakthrough study. And what they did was not simply confirm that it's plague. They confirmed, they reconstructed the structure of the entire genome of Yersinia pestis. And what that does is allow you to compare this 14th century sample to every other sample of Yersinia pestis, no matter where you find it, no matter when you find it. And that is what has led, and this kind of work has continued with other grave sites from other dates, that has led to this. This is the version, most recent version that's published, of what the phylogenetic tree of Yersinia pestis looks like. Phylogenetic tree is a family tree. It's simply saying, okay, here's a strain of plague. This is how it relates, just like a familial relationship with every other plague. And I'll go through this again because this is something we need to break down. But what we can see now in this structure is the entire global history. Not simply the entire globe, but also all of the history. So there at the top in the blue, we have the third plague pandemic, which spread throughout the world at the end of the 19th century and the early 20th century, because rats bearing this strain of plague crawled onto steamboats, then the steamboats sailed around the world carrying the plague with them. We have the Black Death right there. We have a prior outbreak, the Justinianic Plague, starting in the 6th century. And now this point, the parts that are shaded, those are documented by ADNA. ADNA is just simply ancient DNA. It's from sites like the London Black Death Cemetery that has been reconstructed fragment by molecular fragment. And just to explain, well, I said before that plague kills so quickly that there's no trace in the bones. There is, and this is just brilliance that the scientists thought to do this. Plague, as I showed you, by the time at the point of death, it circulates throughout your entire body through your bloodstream. Your teeth have a vascular supply. That's what keeps them alive. But they also have a very hard enamel surface that, if you're not eating too much sugar, actually becomes a time capsule after you die. So that's all of the plague that has been documented through ADNA has come from teeth. So that's what they've been doing, is looking at the teeth of people who've been buried in grave sites. And now, in fact, they can determine other people. So the point is that this late Neolithic transition down at the bottom of the tree has only been documented through ADNA. We never knew that this happened before. That's what this new science is creating for us as historians, is phenomena that we didn't even know we needed to look for. Okay, so let's break this down and just look at this a little more closely. There's our late Neolithic Bronze Age plague time frame, the 3rd to the 1st millennium BCE. geographic range across the Russian steppe, from Asia all the way to Germany. We never knew that we had to look for these phenomena before. Then there is a diagram of the most recent publication, and they are suggesting that this may be involved in the late Neolithic transition, where already archaeologists knew that there was some change, some abrupt change in the density of human populations and where they were located. So it's giving us a new agenda, a new historical agenda of questions to ask and evidence to look for. And again, this lineage, this entire lineage, has only been documented from ADNA. Now, this is a living strain. This still exists in this area of the Qinghai Tibet Plateau. That's how old this lineage is. That's when it was created, was sometime in the late Neolithic. So this is living. There's only two samples of it. But again, we can now structure and say, okay, there's some very old narrative that we need to find out about to tell the story of plague. Moving ahead, still in the third millennium, but again, this is a living strain, all of this in the Caucasus Mountains. So we've looked at the entire Russian steppe, all the way to Germany, we've looked at China, and this is living in the Caucasus Mountains to the present day. So clearly, already our narrative about plague is, it moves. How is it moving? What are the mechanisms? And again, this is a single-celled organism. It doesn't fly through the air. How is it moving around? Oops. Okay, now jumping into historical time. This is the point at which we start to get substantive historical records. First millennium BCE to the 6th century, a geographic range of these strains we'll be looking at is from the border between China and Kyrgyzstan, extending to Africa and England. This is both living and extinct. This is a living strain, which is now on the border between China and Kyrgyzstan. It's called 0Ant1. And then right after it, so we're moving upward in time as we move up the chart. Those are the strains of the Justinianic plague, the pandemic that struck the Mediterranean world starting in the 6th century and continuing to the 8th century. And again, that's all ADNA that we've used to reconstruct that now. And this is the phylogenetic tree in a different orientation that's showing where these samples have come from. But the thing is that, and I'll just have to do this with my hand, where it says circa 541, the first documented outbreak of plague, that's the narrative our historical sources tell us. That all of a sudden in Pelusium and then in Constantinople, we see these major plague outbreaks. That's the historical story we have. But look how much of the story actually precedes that. By hundreds of years. And where does that story take place? Not in the Mediterranean. This sample that's labeled DA101 dies in Kyrgyzstan, back over in Central Asia. And it's postulated now that there's a strain that goes into Kyrgyzstan, and we only have one sample from that, but then also this lineage that becomes the Justinianic plague that sweeps all the way into the Mediterranean and probably Africa as well. And so the emergence of this happens, this is an estimate, but happens sometime between 527 BCE and 153 AD. Those are made-up numbers. As historians, we don't give it credence, but that's a mathematical model that's suggesting this. This is a very big, very long story. And again, a major part of it we didn't have any clue about before. Okay, so back to this. Now jumping ahead to the second pandemic and the Black Death. There's the Black Death, and all of that is documented from ADNA. All of it coming from either from Western Europe or Russia. And this is that same, this is just kind of a skeletal version of that. Precisely to highlight there's an embedded narrative in the Black Death story. The Black Death, as shown here, is that black dot. But you'll notice there's something that happens before that, from which various branches are coming out. That's been called the Big Bang. So remember when I said I showed that map originally and said there's something seemed to be missing from that map? This is what's missing from that map. We've only told the story of, in fact, branch 1A. There's a branch 1B story we have to tell. There's a branch 2 med, branch 2 ant, branch 3, branch 4. And those are just the ones we know about right now. There are all of these stories that we need to tell. Okay, so this is all the what the sciences has put on the table. What can the humanities add? Well, this is going back to the most recent study on the Justinianic plague. Where do all those dates come from? Those are historical sources that are saying plague seems to be or something that we're interpreting as plague. The historical record still has a tremendous amount to tell us, but now the genetics is giving us an infrastructure to tell us what is moving, where is it moving, how is it moving. The sample from Britain, and I won't go back to it because it will take time, but the sample from Britain is actually the earliest strain of plague that we can document now from the Justinianic plague. The earliest one is already gotten to Britain. Again, a story we just didn't know we needed to tell before. Historical sources can give us hints about where the bodies are buried. Archaeologists can then investigate. And this is probably, I suspect that this is a study that will be coming out at some point, is there are bodies buried under this hippodrome in the Levant that will be looked at some point. These are other bodies that presumably will be investigated. This is from Carthage, from North Africa. And again, why do we even know we should look there? Well, in some cases, it's just archaeological digging. In some cases, we're following historical traces. This now is the second plague pandemic, so the beginning of the Black Death. And remembering the story that I told you about the Justinianic plague, that there was an entire narrative that we didn't know we needed to tell. With the Black Death, this is also true, but we're more aware. This is moving into, it's from the 14th century up to the 19th century is the range that we're looking at for the second plague pandemic. These are the ADNA samples that have been found from Europe. And over in the corner there, you can see the red ones. Those are from around the time of the Black Death itself. The ones in orange are just the period right after the Black Death, so the latter part of the 14th century. And then green, and then the blue is getting us up to the 17th and 18th century. So we have a lot of data now. So how did this all happen? And this is, again, go through this very quickly. This is my own research that I've done putting together all kinds of science, putting together, I've been reading about kind of the zoology that's probably involved in plague, reading the genetics, but also going back and rereading historical sources to say, is there something we've been missing? And clearly there has been a lot that we've been missing. How did this happen? And here I'm talking about just the Black Death. This is the argument that I have come to is that there are three factors that come together. There are Mongols, marmots, animal vector, and millet. Okay, so let me explain. So this is from a study that came out in 2017, putting forward some new genetic sequences documenting plague in this area, this border between China and Kyrgyzstan. These are modern samples. And again, I don't have time to explain what's the logical process by which we can argue from modern samples into a historical past. But phylogenetics is the quick answer. But let me just walk you through the data here. Remember when we were looking at the phylogenetic tree before, we were looking at as it more or less laid out in a chronological order, old to new. This is the old. This is where it is on a map. This strain that dates from before the Justinianic plague. Where is it? Up in this area of northern China that's called the Zhongar Basin. And I'll show you another map later to correlate it. This isn't showing topographical relief, but that's a lower elevation. That's the edge of a desert. As you're moving down, the rest of it will be moving into very, very high mountainous territory. So before the Justinianic plague, whatever caused the Justinianic plague, whatever event caused the Justinianic plague, it's something probably connected to that region. Okay, and then in terms of, again, living strains, we jump to after the Justinianic plague. So these are strains that are still alive today, and this is where they live. They've kind of moved into these high mountains. And there's just one sample up there. And now this is right before the Black Death. What has happened? Again, we're moving through this mountain range. And that's the strain that immediately precedes that big bang and goes off in various directions. Now, this is giving you a little bit more of the relief. All of this is happening in this very rough, complicated terrain, but it's also incredibly fertile areas on both sides of this. The main mountain range here is called the Tian Shan Mountains. All this is an incredibly fertile area. Humans are moving back and forth and back and forth through this area constantly. And who moves through it? Oh, it's who also lives there is right there in the center in the areas red and black. Those are the marmot populations that are the hosts of Yersinia pestis, the rodent long-term hosts of Yersinia pestis. That's where they live. So we've got the marmots living there. We've got humans moving through this geographic area. And this, I apologize, this was supposed to be presented in a different order, but at the end of it, you'll see what the argument is. So my argument is that the Mongols come out of Mongolia and come to this region. This is not their first campaigns out of Mongolia, but into the 12 teens. 1218 is when they conquer the area that is modern Kyrgyzstan. So right there. That's what I think the place of the Big Bang is, more or less. So Mongols come out, they conquer the population that was living there prior, called the Karakitai. And then they take plague into China. There are outbreaks that plausibly can be explained as being plague outbreaks in China already in the 13th century. So the Black Death as I'm redefining it, is not a 14th century phenomenon, or it doesn't start then, it starts in the 13th century. So they're carrying it to China. And then it also gets carried through Iran, goes up through the Caucasus, and creates a new reservoir, I think a long-term reservoir, that persists in the Volga River region. And then out of that, that's a later phenomenon, but anyway, we get a 15th century transmission, but see where the blue is. That's what happened in the 14th century. That's the narrative that we've had. But there's all of this other story that we needed to add to that picture. And now it makes biological sense, and I think it also makes historical sense, because basically it's an overlay of the Mongol Empire. Okay, and what are the Mongols doing? I don't have a separate slide for this. What are the Mongols doing? The Mongols come to the area around the Tian Shan Mountains. They find that it's one particular region is produces an excellent quality of millet. They're going on these long campaigns. They need a food supply. The millet produces, it's described very precisely in a certain way. You make a gruel out of this millet, and even a Mongol warrior will be nourished for the whole day. So think about it, the superfood that exists in the 13th century, they find the place that it's produced, and then they're shipping it. There are advanced troops that carry it to the sites where they're besieging various cities. Once the siege is over, they open up these sacks of grain and are actually feeding the people that they've besieging, who in fact they've been starving. And it's at the end of the sieges that these plague outbreaks come out. So we get to the Black Death, and again, this is new data of people, just historians, going back and looking through our material record and seeing these are astronomical mortality figures. But this is what, so an average for the entire Middle East of 42% mortality at the time of the Black Death, with various broken down. This is a map of Cairo. There's apparently a plague burial site under the city of Cairo, equivalent, actually probably bigger than the one that's been excavated for London. This is entirely new work that's just been done in the last couple of years, of asking the question, well, if plague got to the Mediterranean, it got to North Africa, there was a lot of traffic across the Sahara. Could have it also crossed the Sahara, gotten into sub-Saharan Africa? So there's no ADNA that's been found for this work, but it's exploratory. And this is the result of historians and archaeologists coming together and just saying, there's something going on here. And what's going on is precisely this, is what the archaeologists are doing. This is data from West Africa, is saying there's a signal in the archaeological record that's saying something happened, that these population areas are shrinking or being abandoned altogether. Right now, we have no proof about why that might be. So this will be a research that probably is going on maybe for the next 20 years. We don't know. But it's a new kind of question. And why are we even asking this question? Because the genetics is suggesting this was bigger than we ever thought it was. So this is just a summary of this, just using the example of looking at Ethiopia, of asking from different kinds of data, from different disciplinary records, do we have even cause to start to raise the question, did plague affect these areas? And my argument is, there's a certain point at which if you get enough yeses in that column, then that suggests we need to do more research. So that's, I think, will be a kind of a paradigm of our research agenda for the next couple of decades, which now brings us back to where we are today. So you've seen there's a lot of phylogenetics involved here. This map that's being created, this one in particular, this is phylogenetics. This is exactly the same science that's going into understanding our present predicament, which is global. And I'm saying, this is all the same thing. We're asking the same questions. Where did this come from? How did this happen? How did it spread? So this is what I want to leave you then with today. These are the headlines from this morning. Every single one, BBC, New York Times, every single headline is about the coronavirus or the new situations that it's created, politically, economically, culturally. This is work that we need. We need a lot of hands on deck. And that's what I would like to do, is try to elicit more historians being involved with this, more archaeologists being involved with this, and getting us in dialogue with all the other disciplines involved. And with that, I will turn it over to you. Thank you.